project, all the projects are really nice. I feel so basic on mine, but it's pretty good. The teacher as a learner is the centerpiece linking classroom and school improvement. Going into this program, I was a little apprehensive about going into it because I had to take myself out of the teacher role and become a student. So this is me my first day. I said, the holidays are coming, I have assignments, when am I going to do this? I really need my license, to need this class to renew my license. Just going to go ahead and get it over with. So I went in with all of the, I guess, the challenges and the bad thoughts, not really looking at the good things that I was going to learn from the course. So that first day, I was just waiting for 4:30 to get here and so I could get on the road and get ready for the holidays. The first assignment is the teacher that makes the difference in the classroom. So as I looked through the assignments, I realized it wasn't all about me, it was about helping my students. And so I started to look at the assignments in a different way. And after reading the different posts, I said, you know what, I need to really get into this course because it's not just affecting me, it's affecting my students. So I went in and told my students, I'm taking a class. And they're like, Ms. B, what? I said, yes, I'm taking a class, so I'm going to try some things with you all, you know. So if you don't like it, let me know. But if you like it, let me know. So a teacher is also a student. This was my first semester teaching level 4 students. I was normally teaching adult high school and developmental math students. So level 4 students, it's a wide range of students. So it was a learning process for me as well. So in class, well, these aren't my students, but in class, you know, the students, they were excited to learn what I was learning. So out of all of the lessons, my favorite lesson was the algebra tiles. That was the one I hated the most as a teacher because I didn't know how to use the algebra tiles and, you know, teach them to the students. And so the sheet with the expressions and the equations was really helpful. For my adult high school students, I used all of the tiles when we worked with polynomials. And the students at first, they got the tiles and they said, why are we doing this? This is so elementary. And I said, well, just try it. And so I put what each tile represented on the board. And at first, you know, they were, you know, whining and complaining. But as I walked around, I could see that they were getting into the lesson. So before I started teaching adding and subtracting polynomials, we used the algebra tiles. And so I was putting problems on the board, and one person, she was answering all of the questions. Okay, this is the answer to this, because I said, put your pencils away, we'll just use the paper and the tiles, and we separated. So by the end of the lesson, the students were like, I know the answer to the next one. Let me do the next one. Wait, let's get through the next question. So it was really, really good. One thing that I would like to learn from this is how to teach multiplying polynomials with the algebra tiles. So that's something that I'll work on later. But the adding and subtracting went really well. Another strategy I liked was UPS. Understand, plan, and solve. And so the students came and said, well, we have trouble with the applied part of the table. And so I said, well, first we have to understand the problem. And I would put word problems on the board along with different problem-solving strategies and ask them, okay, how would you approach this problem? And one off the top of my head was about a rectangular garden. And so I would put the problem up, have them work on the problem individually, and they would say, Ms. B, did I get this right? I said, I can't tell you, wait, because that was a problem for me because I was always the teacher that would say, no, go and do this. And So I had to step away as the instructor and just allow the students to approach the problem, see if they could solve the problem. And at first I would go around and I said, well, just go back and check your math, or if it's a rectangular garden, you know, so how would you approach the problem? So I guess I did go in a little bit and try to give them a nudge here and there. But it was really interesting to see how students approach different word problems. So twice a week, we would focus on different problem solving strategies and help them to figure out how to solve problems by relating the words within the problem with key terms related to the operations. Not only were the students learning, but I was learning. Because again, as a teacher, we want to teach the students how we were taught. And again, this was a different approach for me because I'm coming from a middle school background and I'm always hands-on with the students, but as adult learners, sometimes they don't want to ask questions, but then some, you know, they do want to ask questions, but you know, it just depends on the environment and the students that are in there. And so by doing some of the strategies, we were all learning. So that was a good part of this whole program for me, as well as the students. One of the other lessons that I enjoyed was getting feedback from the students. And when students say, well, Miss B, there's nothing, you know, you're doing everything that, you know, everything is fine. I said, no, I want you to be honest. I said, because if you're not honest with me, I can't help, you know, the next group of students that are coming for the class, for the next session. And so I used little note cards and had students to write down. And I said, you can be anonymous. You don't have to put your name. And I forgot to put them on there, but I did get some really good feedback from the students. And one thing that I didn't do is provide grades for students because I don't like giving grades. I just like to see the progress, but some students like that as, especially for the level four class, for my adult high school class, of course, I have to do grades, but for the level four, I didn't assign like a grade because I like to see growth and progress with the students. And so that was pretty much one of the things that students said, that they would like a grade to see where they are. And so I said, okay, I can do that. Another thing was, and I got this from Mr. Clark, I had students sitting in pairs the first session. This session, I rearranged the room and I'll have them in groups. I guess having flashbacks as a middle school teacher, having students work in groups, I'm like, oh gosh, this is not going to work. But I'm going to try it this session. Because when they are applying for a job or working in a job setting, they're going to have to learn to work in groups.
Is that a morning or a night class?
This is a morning class.
Okay.
11:15. And it was a large class. This class I had like at the beginning around 37 students. And so when we finished, we were down to maybe 25, 27. Yeah, so we got through it together. I always tell students, because I do teach developmental math, is that if you are planning to transition to the curriculum side, when the instructor looks at the roster, it's not going to have GED, HISET, or adult high school. It's just going to have all the students listed in the course that you're taking. So the expectation is that you're able to do the assigned work for that particular module. So we got our scores back, some improved and some remained the same, but I told them, you know, look at the growth from within, from the past 8 weeks. And so we went around with the different, they gave me feedback, I gave them feedback as well, so that went well. So I look at it as a road to success. A journey of 1,000 miles begins with just one step. And by them coming to class, that inspires me to do more with them. And that lets me know that I am doing something that they're interested in and trying to give them that extra push that they can do it and that eventually they will get to their destination. Destination is graduation and moving past this point. I always tell my students, I said, this is the easy part. I said, the hard part is determining, you know, or deciding what your major is, where you want to go to school, what are your goals and aspirations past this portion. And that's it.
Okay, someone has a question, comment, or thought for Sonia.
So I loved at the beginning your realization about how class, what class can offer and how it affects your students. It's really cool how you turn something that like they hate and then you didn't like into something positive. I was originally not the biggest fan of algebra tiles. And my students weren't either, so I feel you on that, and that really actually helped a lot that somebody else walked away. And then we'll see. I really liked towards the end how you were talking about, it's appreciative that you like love and you care and you focus on like their futures and actually pushing them into the other, you know, past what you're doing right now, because I feel like a lot of times in these type of classes we focus so much on. So it was really nice to hear. Yeah, great presentation.
You teach developmental math, so I would love to hear from your perspective, because the students placing into developmental math is one of my get on my soapbox issues. Anything else that you could share with us that would help us as we work with students to help them be prepared either for if they end up in a few sections of developmental, or how could we help them to bypass developmental? Any words of advice from you being there teaching these DMA classes that you could use to help us as we work with students?
The biggest thing is because in DMA 10, it's calculator inactive. So teaching students their order of operations, the basics of geometry as far as with angles. For them, understanding the integers, that's really big. DMA 20, working with fractions, the first part of DMA 20, they can't use a calculator. Most of the students who place into those classes, they'll tell me that, well, I couldn't use a calculator on the placement, so that's why I'm in this class. But when they get in that class, it is a struggle for them because they lack their multiplication facts. They forget about perfect squares and operations. The other DMA module that they are in is 50, dealing with slope. A lot of students, they can't get slope in bar graphs. And one thing that's really weird, we use my math lab. And when we're looking at the graphs, they'll say, Ms. B, I can't see the graphs. I said, well, let's just enlarge it. They're like, oh. So sometimes just enlarging the graph. But most of the students in the past 3 years that I've been with adult high school, they normally bypass most of their DMAs except 050, which is slow. Because I focus a lot on the fractions, the equations, and the algebra tiles. I think that would be really great in DMA, to help them with DMA 40 with equations. Because once they work with equations, it goes back to integers. They don't understand that, okay, whatever I do this side, you know, I do to the other. So I think the algebra tiles would help a lot. That. They don't really focus too much on 70 and 80, but I do in adult high school, but I don't think we do in bridges.
How do you feel about the advice offered in the course, which was do you teach some with calculator, teach some without?
That was a struggle for me because I don't like using a calculator, and even as a middle school teacher, I would limit the use of calculators with my students. But reading the post and seeing that the DMA students, they don't know how to use a calculator. So I was able to get some TI-30XS calculators, and I'm going to use them this session. But I really feel now that students need to know both, because when they get to a college level, I don't think we have workshops. Now, when I first started here at CP, we used to have TI-83-84 workshops. But as far as the TI-30, we don't have workshops for students to use a calculator. So I think at least having the students familiar with the calculator, because in my DMA class at night, I'm having to take a 5-minute tutorial on calculators to show them how to use the calculators. But this session I'll do both. I'll probably spend the day having them work problems, but then also showing them how to use the calculator.
What's been your experience with how many DMA modules students have been able to pass in a semester? What have you seen? What's typical? I know it's hard to say because everybody's a little different, but what have you seen, anything you could say overall about how many modules a student could realistically pass in a semester?
They can pass all 4 in a semester. It depends. The DMA 20, which is your fractions, and then they'll throw in negative exponents and scientific notation. Students tend to struggle with those.
Mm-hmm.
And then because it's not a traditional class, they're trying to learn that information online, and whenever they take their final exam and they're not understanding the scientific notation, it's 1 greater than 1, less than 10, and then they get the answer incorrect because it's 19 point something, and they're like, it's in scientific notation. I said, no, it's not. So the lower modules, because some of the students aren't really sure about what major they're going into, students tend to repeat those 20 and 30 with conversions.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I found with using algebra tiles, working with positive and negative integers, just the ones, works great with teaching how to add and subtract negative numbers.
And when we're talking about integers, that's what trying to get students to transition from arithmetic to algebra with integers. That's once I can get them to see that we're just, for subtracting integers, we're basically adding the opposite, and understanding that now we're working with integers as opposed to whole numbers and natural numbers, they finally get it.
Well, this is, can I ask a question?
Sure.
This is for you, Sonia, and for anybody else. I mean, so you work with algebra tiles, and other people have too. And then do you also do the number line thing?
Not with my adult high school students.
No, okay.
The Bridges students, I put the number line up.
Okay.
And I did use the ones algebra tiles with them this session. And then they said, we ran out of space with the lines. I said, that's why, we start out with smaller numbers and then do the lines. But
well, how did you teach integers before the algebra tiles?
With integers, I normally taught it with football, going up, going back,